Penguin Random House Audio presents You Were Here by Gian Sardar. Read for you by Emily Rankin, Cassandra Campbell, Kim My Guest, McLeod Andrews, and Scott Brick. Turquoise, magenta, lime, bright bursts of red and gold, flashes of irony from a stone deemed colorless. A wave goodbye could cast a rainbow, a bolt of brilliance from a hand drawing shut a door. A ring that shines with such fire should not be stifled, tucked away in darkness and extinguished. And yet, it has been for decades. First placed in a safe by shaking hands, then hidden in a drawer by someone who no longer believed in romance or diamonds or promises. Until now. Now, a little girl has the ring and holds it in her small, hot hand. The door to the bathroom is shut. Her mother is at work and her grandmother asleep. Carefully, the girl places the ring on her thumb, and with each turn of the stone, each reflected color, a moment flashes in her mind. A moonlit dinner by a river. A kiss among vines and white flowers, a breathless confession as footsteps draw closer. But then the door swings open. Her grandmother is standing there, and immediately her eyes find the ring, that ring she'd never wanted to see again. Get it off! Get it off now! 1. Now. That deep blue of summer, endless and brilliant. The heat seems to come with a noise like insects, a noise that shimmers. Coolers hold down blankets and bees are gathered at trash cans. Abby is lying in the sand, happy, but when she turns, the ocean is gone, replaced by a dark meadow. The waves now undulations of tall, dry grass. The sky's gone gray, a storm churning, gathering. This was the noise she heard, the storm's approach. In a flash, she sees it, the giant oak tree, black limbs snaking into an ashen sky. At its base is a table set for two, always set for two. A crystal chandelier quivers on the branch above. It's been years since she's been here, and understanding bangs her heart into a furious rhythm as suddenly she's sinking, unable to move. The sand that had been so soft a moment before, now dirt that spills into her mouth. At once she's choking, gasping, waking to a bed soaked with sun, sheets shoved to the floor. Outside, a dove's cry turns to a demand. Who? 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 The dark meadow. The nightmare that started in high school and recurred once or twice a month until she left Minnesota. An ending that's always the same. Suffocation. Desperate gasps for breath. The one time she'd gone home during college, brave with longing and rested from a year of unplagued sleep, the dream had returned like a waiting, loyal friend. Never again has she been back. Never again has she had the dream. Until now. It's been 14 years, she tells Robert later, in the car. He was asleep when she left, and she's waited to tell him in person. Though her voice holds striations of panic, he doesn't understand. Words are a pale shadow of meaning. 14 years since I've had the dream. One nightmare, he says, is one nightmare. Try not to worry, okay? The air conditioning blasts, her toes chilled. The entrance to the freeway is in an old residential neighborhood, and the once proud houses are faded, pockmarked with missing siding. Glass shimmers in the gutter.
"Anxiety," she says. "That's what they used to say. But it never made sense. They stopped when I left for college. If anything, I was more stressed."
"You had an estate visit today?" An attempt to change the subject, to loosen her mind's grip. She tries to let him, to take herself from the meadow and join him in a recap of her day, her work at the antique jewelry store and the estate trips it involves, crowds of family photos on shelves, paintings darkened with time, marriages that last longer than most lifetimes, or end faster than the turn of a season. A screenwriter, Robert loves the stories Abby collects. "Tell me more," a constant refrain in their relationship, a request made as they fall asleep at night or while walking down boulevards flanked with magnolia trees, flowers as wide as saucers. 48 years they'd been married, she says, though she still sees the tremor in the oak tree's leaves, feels the dirt that fell into her mouth. The wedding ring was her mother's, once sewn into the hem of a dress in Poland. Then they're on the freeway, the oldest in Southern California. "Made for horses," she tells people. "You enter from a stop sign, 0 to 60 in the time it takes to change the radio station." Robert changes lanes to pass a car, and out of the corner of her eye, she feels another driver doing the same. She looks away. "Think pretty. One of the rings from today. An aquamarine the same pale blue as a pool's shallow end. A welcome glimmer in a June light." Still, the freeway's energy pulses, gathers for impact, and her legs push against the floor. Death, accidental and early, has always been her preoccupation. Horrible images exist behind Abby's eyes. Pretty eyes. Eyes that laugh. Eyes that should not look for such things. "Girls who wear pink should not think your thoughts," she was once told by an ex-boyfriend who did not understand that she chose these colors, these bright, soft colors, precisely because of what exists in her mind. "Did I ever tell you I didn't get my license till I left Minnesota?" she says. "All those one-lane highways, the accidents. That and my mom tried teaching me on a stick." A three-point turn, the car rolling forward, angled into the street, other drivers patient but waiting. Abby had simply thrown it into park, gotten out, and run to the passenger side. Her mother had no choice but to take over. "I was at the DMV on my birthday," Robert says. Robert, at his core, is logic. A calm voice. A man who highlights when he reads. Straight hair and ironed shirts. Abby is always, without fail and from the start, a few decibels too loud. Chaos. The person who drops the book in the bathtub. Curly hair that tends to knot. And nail polish that's always chipped. All reasons he loves her, she knows. She's his voice when he wants to scream. The mess he longs to make. He flicks on the blinker, then glances over his shoulder. "Wine?" "I had it." But even as she's saying this, she's looking in the back seat and not seeing it. That bottle with its graceful lettering, better than they normally drink, more expensive than they normally allow. Chosen especially for the evening, for her best friend Hannah's first dinner at her first house. Left on the kitchen counter.
"We get lucky then," Robert says. "Tomorrow night, in and out, burgers and Bordeaux. You sent them those cheese knives, right?"
"Last week, but we can't show up empty-handed."
As they exit, Abby sees their only hope will be some convenient store bottle best suited for cooking. "Here, to put in the pasta," she'll say when Hannah, a wine rep, long red hair and an impeccable palate, answers the door. Somehow it seems fitting that Abby's failed in this, the simple ability to bring a bottle of wine to dinner. Left behind. That's how she feels. The 33-year-old trapped in an apartment. In a relationship without a ring. Marriage? A house? Children?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.